Good day, dear students. Today we are starting yet another poem, and that poem is more or less a recognition of the identity of a person. The recognition of an identity of a person means who that person is, what she is at present, and at what time she had been having a different identity. So in a way it is like speaking to the early ancestors and trying to tell them what that person is. The reason why I am mentioning these ancestors is that the poet Diane Glancy is a playwright. She is also an essayist. She is a fiction writer. She is a poet, definitely. And she came to know that she is now not just American. She is more than that. And this is what really troubled her, because she feels that it is now, she is part of the Cherokee tribe. And her father was a Cherokee and mother English-German. And so naturally, this awareness was already there. But she learned something about the Cherokee tribe. And that is, when the title Cherokee is mentioned, naturally the thought comes to your mind that it is about Red Indians, and this is one tribe, and they all have this intense attitude towards other people. They kill and keep the head as a trophy. All these are the thoughts that comes to our mind. And this is exactly the thought that was there in the mind of Diane Glancy, until she learned differently from her school days and from the school lessons, that the tribe to which she was born was actually not just the killer tribe, but they were agriculturalists. So here you find that Diane Glancy was a person who had accomplished a lot, but she is backtracking about her own identity, and the identity as a Cherokee Indian. So as a teacher of Native American culture at McAllister College in Minnesota, she was able to teach much about the Native American culture. And you will also find that in America there is a university which is specially for Native Americans, or an Indian university, not our India, but the Native Indians Red Indians of America. And for them there is a university where they teach a lot of the stories, folk tales, folklore. And there is a post called the storyteller. The living or the person is a storyteller, and she is an extremely old lady, but she still remains the head of that department. And so they are recreating through the stories the Native American culture. For a time, the white men were trying to destroy the American culture and taking the Native American children to certain groups or to a place where they will be looked after and they'll be taught the white man's culture. But now they are given a chance to go back to their own native culture from after learning the white man's culture. Okay, so in that manner you will find that they could really now express the thoughts that pass through their mind in the white man's language and publish it also. And because they have become really adept in publishing and also making it known to the world. And this is how Diane Glancy is introduced to us. So these Native Americans were highly dependent on the buffalo, that is especially this Cherokee. They were an integral part of their life, this Cherokee Indians. So Glancy learned about it. So the poem has a dedication, and the dedication is for my father, who lived without ceremony. So you will be wondering what ceremony. The reason is that as an Indian, as a Cherokee, they have a lot of ceremony. Means if you reach the age, if you become an adult, then that adult adulthood or becoming a man is indeed celebrated. And maybe they go for hunting and bring back something. And that in itself is regarded as the first step towards manhood. And it is, there will be a ceremonial song and dance and everything. So naturally, this man, her father, who is a Cherokee, is now living without a ceremony. It is to that person that she is dedicating this song, this poem. And the poem has an unusual title. The unusual title is Without Title. Okay, so you can find out that discrepancy or even the incongruency of the title of the poem, that is Without Title. So here you find that, we'll think about the title later, because only as you go through the poem you'll understand what it is to live without a title, or what it is to live without the tribal support or the tribal ceremonies and the tribal culture. So she is addressing this poem to her Cherokee father. So the poem begins like this. It's hard, you know, without the buffalo, the shaman, the arrow, but my father went out each day to hunt as though he had them. He worked in the stockyards. All his life he brought us meat. So here you find these lines very simple itself. It is hard, you know, without the buffalo. It is hard to live in this world, in this modern sophisticated world, without buffalo. This is what his her father is thinking. And to live without the shaman, without the arrow. And even then, my father went out each day to hunt. So Diane Clancy is now regarding her father as part of the tribe. And that part of the tribe means being a Cherokee. What will he do usually? He'll usually go for hunting and he will kill an animal, especially a buffalo, and will bring the meat to the table for his family. This is what he will do. So every day he went out each day to hunt as though he had them, as though he had the buffalo, as though he had the shaman, as though he had the arrow, and went out for work here. In this case, it is work, but she says he went out to work, went out to hunt. Then she says, he worked in the stockyards. Stockyards is the modern world. And in a way, the modern world had offered him a job in the stockyards. All his life, he brought us meat. Every day he goes to work. And going to work, he brings in a salary, which is equivalent to meat or something to eat. Occupying a position as part Cherokee and part English or German, Diane Clancy digs deeper to understand her Cherokee inheritance. She was surprised to learn of the agricultural inheritance of the Cherokee, especially her father's tribe. To think of him separated from his tribe, without the buffalo, the shaman, the arrow, it all makes us sad, because every day he is going, every day he is bringing back something, food for them. In a way, she is now picturing him as part of Cherokee and going for hunting and then coming back. But now without buffalo, shaman and the arrow. And the thing is that he is working in a stockyard and he is bringing meat every day to the family. So in a way she is translating that Cherokee tribal life to the modern world life. And she says her father went for work in the stockyards and brought them food as a responsible Cherokee man. The difference is that he is not hunting now, but earning a salary to buy meat. So earning a salary means every day he goes to work, he earns money, and with that money they buy food for the family. And I must say, it must be food and not just meat. Meat is an integral part of their food, but at the same time, you find that it is, in a way, quite necessary for them to understand that in a way, this is something that he needs to understand. So, he went for work in the stockyards, as I told you, and like a responsible Cherokee man, he brings back meat. She says, "No one marked his first kill, no one sang his buffalo song. Without a vision, he had migrated to the city and went to work in the packing house. So, when he brought home his horns and hides, my mother said, 'Get rid of them.' So here she says, 'No one marked his first kill,' means maybe the first salary or the first hunting expedition and the day he killed the animal for meat for the family. And no one sang his buffalo song. And when you make the first kill, the others of the tribe will encourage him by singing the buffalo song. But there is no one to sing that. Without a vision, he had migrated to the city. Without a vision, in the sense that without thinking about much about the future, maybe it is the need of the times that made him migrate to the city, and where he got work in the packing house. And he one day, even though he was working home, maybe he was sick or homesick for his Cherokee tribe. So when he got some horns and hides once, he brought it home, thinking that it will be appreciated by his wife and children. But on bringing it back to the house, he brought horns and hide, as which is the symbol which actually belongs to the man who had killed the animal. He brings it to the house. His wife, that is Diane Glancy's mother, said, "Get rid of them. It is time to get rid of them, because you can't have that in the house." If he were with his tribe, someone would have marked his first kill and sang the buffalo song. But here in this new atmosphere, he is lonely. He had migrated to the city without thinking about his future and went on to work as any ordinary working man. And he is one person who is putting aside his inheritance. And inheritance and whatever that he had earlier as a Cherokee man. Once he brings home the horns and hides, which ought to be the price or the gift for the winner, or the one person who had hunted, the trophy, that is the horns and hides. And her mother asked him to get rid of it, because as a modern young woman, she knows quite well that these are savage customs. And moreover, in a civilized world, they looked quite barbaric. So this just cannot be done. So without much ado, or without saying much about it, he just got rid of it. That's what we have to assume had happened. Then in the next few lines, "I remember the animal tracks of his car out the drive, in snow and mud, the aerial on his old car waving like a bowstring." And she continues saying that there are the animal tracks of his car. Animal tracks means usually when you go for hunting, you track the animal. And that is how you reach the animal to be hunted, where it had gone, the footprints it had made, from where it had started nibbling some greenery here and there. All this will be noted by an efficient hunter. And this is part of growing up in the Cherokee tribe, and they get training like this, and this is how they use their skill against the animal. And she says, "I remember the animal tracks of his car out the drive in snow and mud, the aerial on his old car waving like a bowstring. I remember the silence of his lost power, the red buffalo painted on his chest. Oh, I couldn't see it, but it was there, and in the night heard his buffalo grunts like a snow. So here you find a lot of things that the girl, the daughter, remembers about the father. And that is, she remembers how he drew his car. Maybe that is exactly what happened, but she is translating it, or in a way she is using it metaphorically to be like he is tracking the, or he is tracing the tracks of an animal, and he is going out for hunting. And in the snow and in the mud, these wheels of the car could be found, and you can trace those wheels and this prints and understand that he has gone away in such and such direction. And the aerial on his old car started waving, and that was like a bowstring, like the bow and arrow that a Cherokee will use for hunting. This man is also going for hunting in his car with the aerial, and to the daughter it looked like the bow and arrow, and he is riding a horse, or in a way he is trying to track the animal that he is going to hunt. So here the daughter is putting the metaphor of a hunter tracking the animal and the person going for a job in the modern world. And so that comparison, that metaphor is very much evident there. And she speaks of the animal tracks, and that is the tracking of the impression made by the car wheels on the mud and also on the snow. The power is here, the power is symbolized by the buffalo, and he still feels the power of the buffalo, which is part of his inheritance. And the daughter imagines him riding with a bow and arrow, which metaphorically speaking is indeed the aerial, which is the aerial of his old car, waving in the asset. As the car moves and as the wind reaches this aerial, it just starts moving. It is so fragile, you know, and this is what happens. So she is imagining her father riding the buffalo or even another animal, and this is what the car is for her. And so she puts that metaphor very clearly here, and she remembers fondly the tribe, or that is the fond remembrances of his tribe takes on the form of the painted red buffalo on his chest. The daughter very clearly remembers the painted red buffalo on his chest, which is now covered because he is sleeping, and he is wearing a shirt also, we have to assume. And because of that, she can't see the red painted buffalo on his chest, but she knows that it is there because she had been seeing her father from a very young age, and she knows this painted red buffalo. She did not give a second chance or a second thought to this painted red buffalo, and she did not think of this having any connection to his tribe or his life or earlier culture or the life that he had earlier as part of Cherokee. So from where she is sitting, she can see it. That is, she can see the painted red buffalo on his chest, but she is sure that it is there. The surety that a daughter has as a child has, that the father still had the painted red buffalo on his chest. At night when he snored, it is like buffalo grunts. She again brings in the word buffalo, and this is to affirm the fact that she is speaking about the Cherokee tribe, where the buffalo is the mainspring, or buffalo meat is eaten, and they have a lot of rituals and ceremonies connected with buffalo. And so the snoring is now considered to be the grunting of the buffalo. Maybe there is a similarity, but she is not using it in a humorous manner. She is using it in a way affirming her ancestry as a Cherokee. So very clearly she is equating those practices of a Cherokee with the life that her father is leading now. And as a civilized person, he need not bother with his Cherokee inheritance, but he just can't leave it, because though he had left the place and had come over to this country or a different country to a different civilization, he did not have any plans about the future. Because earlier you will find that he had migrated to the city without a vision. And that is indeed very true of not just Dan Clancy's father, but also for a lot of other tribal people or Native Americans. They think that there is something in store for them in the civilization, so they leave their tribe and its culture and become part of it, only to realize that by being part of this civilization had brought in memories of their old culture, and they long for that, because they think that that would have been, or they have traces of that even in their life, though they knew quite well that they can't go back and become hunters and hunt buffalo and bring meat like they used to do. It is just not possible, and have a painted face, or even dancing and shaman and hunting. It is just not possible for them to have that. But even then, they just remember what it had been before. So Dan Clancy is recreating those memories. And so she portrays the present situation of her father, who is a Cherokee. She uses simile and metaphor, that is figures of speech, to connect the past with the present. The past of her father, her own culture, which she inherited from her father, and so now it is also her own culture, and the present, which is the fact that she is an American, and Native American at that, and she is trying to combine both, and by the effective way she does that is with the use of figures of speech. And she begins the poem with a proper dedication. And here you find that this proper dedication is of the poem is indeed an acknowledgement of her Cherokee inheritance. When you read about Dan Clancy, you will understand that she is indeed a feminist of the first rate, and she can really stand and speak for herself. But when she learned about her Cherokee inheritance, she is quite proud of that fact. Though she had not known anything about the shaman or the bowstring or even the hunting, it is now her part, because she had bothered to learn more about them and also about their culture. And so here you find that this is indeed something that she needs to acknowledge. And this acknowledging can be done only if you have someone to be with them, with her, and especially her father is there. And she watches the father. And so she thinks that while he's sleeping, snoring, maybe he is remembering the grunts of the buffalo. And even though he had this red buffalo painted on his chest, he is not opening his shirt and showing it to the whole world. He is keeping it with him on his skin, and it is there with him always. And the daughter had not given a second thought to that painting, but now she finds a lot of meanings there. And every day he drives his car and goes through the snow and the mud, and the car wheels make an impression there. But he thinks that he is going for hunting, and he is tracking the animals. And finally, he will slay them and bring the meat to his family. This is what a Cherokee will do. And this is what the Cherokee, that is Dan Clancy's father, is doing now in his imagination. But in reality, he is working in a stockyard, and he brings home a salary, which puts meat on the table for the whole family. And so you will find that it is a combination of a lot of facts, a combining of a lot of things, like the Cherokee inheritance plus the civilized world in which they are living, and the children who had grown up without knowing much about his Cherokee inheritance. Maybe the reason is that he had no time to speak to them about his tribe. And the other reason is that the children are growing up in a civilization and they are not bothered by that. And because they would like to be part of that civilization and they would like to be one with the American white children. And so naturally, they would have ignored the Cherokee inheritance. But as they grew up, especially the daughter Diane Clancy, she is now learning more about it and had learned about it, and she is expressing herself through her poems, through her short stories, and through her other writings, what it is to be part of a different culture, a culture other than the one in which she was born and brought up. And it is that culture she is searching for and is trying to find traces of it even in her life also. She finds it in her father's life, and she imagines how it is or how difficult it must have been for him to live in this life without shaman or without hunting or without even tracking the animals, things like that, and without his buffalo song. So here you find Diane Glancy, the daughter, tracing the Cherokee inheritance, at the same time feeling a lot of sympathy for the father, which is why she had dedicated the song, the poem, to her father. And so you find that that dedication is significant. And the significance is that for my father who lived without ceremony. And the title of the poem is Without Title. The father is now living without a title, means he had no titles. No, maybe we can say that he is not the tribal chieftain, he is not the second in chief, and he is a Cherokee, part of Cherokee tribe, that is okay, but that is not a title. So maybe she is trying to make this poem to be a poem dedicated to all those people who had moved from one culture to another, accepting one and at the same time keeping the other a little bit intact in their inner self. And maybe it is because of that you find Diane Glancy and her poem really remarkable. So here, dear students, is a remarkable poem. And a daughter's dedication to the father indicates how much she respects the father and how understanding she is about the Cherokee inheritance. Even though she was born and brought up in the modern or the civilized American life, and she is also a professor in a college, so you can imagine how it is for her to be part of that tribe and culture and recreate or learn more about it through her job and also through her writing. So she got this inheritance through her father, and so she is dedicating the poem to him as a way of thanking him. And in a way, she is also coming to terms with the fact that she is part of a Cherokee tribe, and they are not the headhunters as it was thought to be. Headhunters means if you have an enemy, then they will plan and plot to kill the enemy, behead them, and collect as many skulls as possible, because it is the rage for the young men of the tribe to kill as many people as possible and bring their skull and string them and bring it, and they'll be greeted with the great songs and dance in their tribe. This is what Red Indians usually are or pictured to be. But there is a difference here, because the father of Dan Glancy comes from a Cherokee tribe, which was mostly an agricultural tribe. Means they did not kill human beings. They lived by agriculture, but they have a difference. They used to kill the buffaloes and they used to cultivate the land, and this is the only thing that they had. And they also used to hunt also. Other than that, they never used to go for head hunting, which was the main item for a lot of Red Indian tribes. And this is what we have heard in common. But she learned otherwise from her school lessons, and so she was eager to explore more about it, and she successfully did that. So students, go through the pages which will give you more details about Diane Glancy. At the same time, read the poem and also try to understand the poem and a daughter's thoughts clearly, which is clearly expressed there. Thank you.